what I'm going to do is try to point out some of the choke points that I see with how an outbreak would unfold and where those little points are that we need to be concerned about animal welfare so we can develop approaches to try to lessen the impacts on animals. And so first thing, most folks, if you're familiar with the OIE, back in the day they had list A and list A, B diseases. If you were a disease that made list A, you were a naughty disease. You were one of those ones that was considered a transboundary, highly contagious, moves like wildfire regardless of international borders. And if you made that list, then there were implications to any country that had that disease. And what that ultimately did for those countries is cause some serious problems with trade, and you had to have disease responses. And so one of our challenges, though, is that if you take a disease like foot and mouth, which is on list A, or the old list A, but it is one of those transboundary diseases, in the United States today, we'd run into some real problems if we had this disease. And a lot of that is because the implications to trade. We ship 25 to 27% of pork products internationally. It adds about $30 value back to the price of a pig today. And if we had FMD, we would lose that. The thing that we have to keep in mind is that the traditional responses to foreign animal diseases is we're going to contain these things, euthanize these animals, and dispose of them to get our trade back quicker. And for our industry, while we are acutely sensitive to the value of the trade adds to our product, we also recognize that if we had an outbreak tomorrow, we've got 50 states here that have to learn to work well and play nice with one another so we could at least continue the 75% of production that stays domestically. And so I've often looked at the disease and the planning now, and that, you know, if you have a better way to manage the disease, you don't necessarily have to default to euthanasia and disposal as your method, because you have some time to actually look at the scope of the outbreak and kind of determine what actually is the appropriate approach. But sometimes we default to the most severe in an effort to try to do it. So a lot of these diseases are also diseases of trade, which drive decision making, and it's not necessarily as based on science. It's more based on the I'm thinking I'm going to get my trade back and be back in business. And so but there's a value. There's a value to any industry in a country that doesn't have foot and mouth disease, classical swine fever, African swine fever, avian influenza, exotic Newcastle disease. But we wanted to get an idea of what that value was, and because in order to try to move forward in our industry and put our resources, our checkoff resources, towards things that will benefit producers, we kind of wanted to look at what cross-commodity effects were on an FMD outbreak, just to kind of get an idea of what it would cost all of our industries. And if you add up all those numbers between pork, beef, poultry, corn, soybeans, and wheat, that comes to roughly around $200 billion over 10 years. That's just the cost of getting the disease. That's not the response. That is basically what you take off the top. You skim that off the top, and that's what the agriculture industries are going to lose the day of an outbreak. And this was a model that we funded up at Iowa State with Dermot Hayes. But one thing that he did for us that was really neat, and that's the second bullet right here, is that he went and actually estimated what it would be worth to the pork industry to prevent foreign animal diseases from entering the United States, specifically foot and mouth disease. And the number was pretty staggering. $137 million is what really we could be investing today to offset the financial losses. I mean, that's kind of our new number that when people talk about, well, what's it worth to do planning? What's it worth to do preparedness? What's it worth to keep these diseases out? I say, well, to us, it's worth $137 million a year to do that. And so the first way that I think you could protect welfare in the United States from a foreign animal disease outbreak, don't have the daggum disease to begin with. And so we tend to throw our resources into those things that raise the awareness of pork producers regarding disease detection and who to report it to and biosecurity and what products you shouldn't bring back from other countries and what biosecurity kids should have when they're raising their show pigs. And we have all these resources available at pork.org to producers, but as well as folks in the audience here, to really help raise awareness of producers out there. And that's our number one goal. Let's just keep it out. And anything we can do to keep it out is going to actually protect the welfare of our animals on a day-to-day basis. Obviously, the diseases themselves cause some problems with welfare. All of these are various foreign animal diseases. The top one is foot and mouth in a cow, foot and mouth disease in swine, exotic Newcastle's disease in poultry. A lot of these diseases are really good at taking a healthy animal and turning them into a dead animal in less than 24 hours, or you end up with problems with sloughing hooves in the case of vesicular diseases, especially foot and mouth disease, animals that can't eat. And obviously it's important to realize that if we get these diseases here, there's going to be welfare implications just from the diseases themselves. And as I thought through the process, one of the only things that I could come away with is that really, even in the face of a foreign animal disease outbreak, there's still responsibilities that people have to take care of their animals. And I worry a lot that when we start setting up zones and if we're not communicating the right messages to producers, we're going to end up with animals where they're not going to be getting feed. They may not be getting basic husbandry anymore. People may not want to do timely euthanasia or just be too shell-shocked with the fact that we have these diseases. And so having those resources available, and even if it's classical or African or foot and mouth disease, we'll still have animals that you'll have to consider timely euthanasia. And I know we've got some resources on that, and I know other species groups too. But it's one of those things where you've just got to take into account that, yeah, we got foot and mouth disease, but we still have to treat these animals or at least make sure that we're taking care of them and addressing welfare issues, even though we've got some nasty foreign animal disease that's causing some turmoil. We've done a lot of planning with USDA. There's a lot of different books out now, but the Red Book for Foreign Animal Disease for Foot and Mouth Disease has been out for a while, and obviously these things have been considered by USDA as far as, you know, methods and how you're going to approach euthanasia and how you approach your disease response. But I wanted to kind of give you a response 101 and try to point out those little choke points I was talking about as where I see some issues. If you take a look at what the goals are, have you ever been to despair.com? If you like the antithesis of successories, this is the website I go to. I want to look at the goals for the response to a foreign animal disease has changed since about 2001 when I first started working for the State Department of Ag. This says goals. It's best to avoid standing directly between a competitive jerk and his goals. So let's look at USDA's goals. Back in the day when I first worked with the State Department of Ag and I wrote the plan for Iowa, and the plan was we are going to stop movement, we're going to euthanize animals, we're going to dig holes, and we're going to dispose of them appropriately. And as I've been working through that, and then as I got into the industry and started doing the same thing, over time, I think all the folks that were doing emergency planning realized we got to work a little smarter and not harder. We've got to figure out other opportunities to address these diseases, because if you really take a look at how animals move today and how agriculture works today, that model of trying to contain it has a lot of challenges. And so as opposed to if you were to read this 10 years ago, now it says we need to detect it, control it, contain it as quickly as possible. We need to get rid of it, but we need to use strategies. And this is the important part. It says stabilize animal agriculture, the food supply, the economy, and protect public health. And we also need to be in a science risk-based mode to do this. And that really, to me, is a great message that, hey, look, we've really got to look at the scope of the outbreak to try to determine what the appropriate response is. And so if we have an outbreak tomorrow, the first thing that in the Red Book that it says is we're going to set up what are called control areas. And I'm not going to tell you what exactly these things are, because I don't have a whole lot of time. But the thing is that when we have an outbreak, what you're going to see on the landscape in those areas where you have those first cases is that we're going to be setting up these control areas. And these control areas are basically where you're going to focus your disease control measures to try to make a difference. And so one area that I'm concerned about is that if the state veterinarian doesn't necessarily have as much information as they need to kind of tailor that zone, they're actually going to throw a fairly wide net around this thing in order to try a semblance of containment. And so one of our challenges as industry is as these zones are going into place, making sure that we are communicating with pork producers is exactly what's going on, what the disease is, what the new rules are. We have to get information into their hands in order to allow them an opportunity to best take care of the animals that they have, because These zones just don't pop up overnight, and they certainly don't get enforced overnight either. It's one of those things where once you start setting these zones up, then you have to do those communication steps with the producers in order to let them know. Now, in my world, on the planning side, you know, those communication things didn't necessarily include welfare, but as I started working through this process in my mind for this talk, I started thinking about what are those messages that we need to send out to producers in the face of an outbreak, the first 24, the first 48, the first 72. I know what to send them as far as what your biosecurity is, but I hadn't really thought about what to send them as far as how you should handle the animal welfare on your farm when you're in a stop movement situation, or you're in a situation where there's no known information other than we've got a problem in your area and we'll get back to you. The real deal here with these zones is that what you have to do is you set them up, you actually have to figure out where everybody is. And not only do you want to know where your producers are, but you want to know where all your other assets are, where your milk plants are, where your packing plants are, where are your livestock markets. All of those things can play a role in an outbreak. And so one of the ways that we can support producers is to help, or as producers we can support our state veterinarians, is to help provide information that they can use in an outbreak to make really good decisions as far as how big that zone should be. The reason that's important is because if you cast a really, really wide net, you're going to get a lot more farms caught up in a stop movement. That means a lot more opportunities for animals to undergo some real problems when it comes to animal welfare. And I'll talk a little bit more about that on the swine side in a second. Realistically, when I was with the State Department of Ag, if we had this big magical database with prem IDs in it and we knew where our farms were and we kind of had an idea of some of the production parameters on the farm as far as animal numbers, that would be a good thing. But when I worked for the State Department of Ag, a lot of this work was going to be done just driving that area to find farms, which again increases the amount of time for you to actually have implement your response components to try to contain the disease. And what it ultimately ends up is a period of time there where there's not a lot of information to provide producers. And so again, from the welfare standpoint, what the heck do you give to them at that stage when they're hearing messages from the public in the public sector about this horrible disease? They may have it on their farm or their neighbor has it. They can't move their animals anywhere. So what are those messages that you need to provide to them? And I'm not sure I have the answer to that. We're going to be working on addressing that. I'll talk about that in a little bit. So, anybody who's seen a presentation of mine before probably has seen the answer, but what's the number one thing that you need in an outbreak? And that's information. And you need good information. And it's got to be accurate. And I don't care if we're dealing with welfare or we're dealing with biosecurity or we're dealing with response. If our state veterinarians don't have good, accurate information, they're going to have a hard time making a lot of the good decisions that will help producers manage their animals, help with welfare issues. In my mind, if you have accurate information, that's going to help the government folks or everybody figure out what the scope of the outbreak is, and that's going to help with our response and then the best opportunity for us to recover from it. And again, this goes back to how does this affect welfare? Well, in my mind, if we can provide enough information that state vet can make that infected zone as small as possible with assurances that disease hasn't spread out of that, that's going to decrease the number of farms that you're going to have involved in this, and it's going to help increase or benefit the welfare because you're not going to have as many people covered under a stop movement or some kind of disease control measure. Like I said, the day of an FAD event, there's going to be a huge net thrown out there to try to contain this thing. And how big that net is dependent upon what information is available for state veterinarians and USDA to make better decisions on how to contain this thing and address it. Today, if we were to draw our little quarantine or control areas and do that type of work, the data that's associated with the PREM IDs that we've been working in our industry to provide the state veterinarian really only provide just a way to contact that producer. It doesn't really give the state a whole lot, or state vet a whole lot of information to work with on. Well, they know the species that are there, but you know, what type of production? Is this a sow farm? Is this a poultry barn? As well as the numbers that are there, the animal movements that have occurred. You know, a lot of that information is not readily available at the fingertips of a state veterinarian when they're trying to set up their zones. We've been working real hard on secure movement supply plan, the secure pork supply plan, in an effort from a response standpoint to provide information to the state veterinarian that would help them make better decisions as to what exactly is going on in a particular area. And so as we work forward on these things, our industry has decided that, yep, it's probably a good thing to share with the state veterinarian that what are the number of animals on that farm, those movements that have occurred, because that helps them also look at an area and set up an appropriate size zone. But other things that would be good to supply a state veterinarian would be a disease status for these particular diseases. What we're really trying to approach and secure pork supply is if Dr. Schmidt in Iowa draws his control zone, that he actually has some data as to those farms, where they are, the numbers, but more importantly, what's their disease status. If we set this thing up right, he'll have historical data and current data that would help support that, hey, you know what, this swine farm in this area and this area here, we have reasonable assurance that these guys are still negative. Now, how does that relate to welfare? Well, if we as industry can demonstrate a high confidence that our animals are negative or lack of, or have an absence of infection for that particular disease, that's going to provide opportunities for us to actually move animals in a controlled movement fashion, which is going to help us on the side of, for us, you can stop movement off the farm, you've got about 3 days to a week before you start running into some backlog problems, and I'll show that to you in a second. So I'll make the case today that if we really want to maximize our ability to help protect animal welfare during an outbreak, we really have to have the ability to have information at the fingertips of the state veterinarian to make a better choice, draw a smaller zone, determine who can move and who can't. All this stuff needs to be done before an outbreak as well, because all of it would be done after one, so you might as well build it now and learn how to share that information. And we've been working on that pretty heavily over the last couple of years. All right, I'll get away from my plug for ID. I want to talk a little bit about the most popular method that you always hear about of trying to contain a disease, and that's stop movement. From 2001 till today, I bet you if you asked 50 producers out there and said, hey, what do you think is going to happen, there's going to be a national stop movement. All right, well, I can understand, and as I planned for the state, I thought that's what we should do. But I want to show you why I'm 180 degrees different in that. Maybe we ought to start looking at the day of an outbreak, what's tomorrow's rules for movement, as opposed to trying to stop movement of an industry. And I'm going to use pork, but this could go for any livestock industry, especially those that move a lot of animals on the road. Back in 2008, I did some table napkin stuff with a couple of folks, and we kind of came up with this magic number that there's about 624,000, 25,000 pigs on the road at any given time, about 2,200 semi-loads. Now, Dr. McKean and I were table napkin, doing some table napkin calculations, because he challenged me and said that's a little bit low, and so we worked through some of the numbers, and I would be comfortable in saying you could probably double that. There's probably a million at any given time on the road. And so for us, if the day of an outbreak there's a problem and people decide that they're going to stop movements going in and out of states, we're going to have a lot of pigs and a lot of trailers with no home. When you look at our slaughter capacity, and you can, you know, look at milk processing plants or poultry processing plants, there's a lot of companies out there that have a lot of contracts to meet in order to provide the products for their folks to make, to sell, so people have good, wholesome food in the United States to eat. And so, you know, if you take a look at, we've got 56 packing companies out there, 84 plants. On a daily basis, we're looking at about 444,000 head. If you look at what we're doing on a week, maybe 2.4 million pigs are moving to the packers at any given time. These packers are producing 450 million pounds of product, 360 million pounds for domestic use, and 90 million pounds for export. So as I look at these things and I start going, all right, if we're going to start stopping supply from making it to a packing plant or stopping animals from moving to the next production phase, we're starting to affect all the ability for these packers and processors to actually put product on the shelves. And for me, from a consumer standpoint, that's probably worse than the disease itself, because people start thinking there's something wrong. There's something wrong with your food. And our first message during a foot and mouth disease or any type of outbreak for the foreign animal diseases is your food is safe. And that's what we worry the most about, is making sure consumers still want to eat. here's where all our plants are. And so on any given day, you're going to have some pig on a truck going to some plant for production for processing purposes. So things that I worry about, if we're going to do stop movements, what's the value that we've gained there? If you look at how long a disease is probably circulating in the United States before it's detected and we do our investigation, on a given day, if we decide that's the day to stop movements, I'm wondering what we've really gained if the disease has been moving around. You just basically gain one extra day. And so for me, I hear a lot about, well, we're going to be either stopping movements or we're going to set up some checkpoints. And you know, from what I've learned from Sherry Niekamp and some of the studies that we've been working on or have funded, is that any time that you stop a semi with pigs in it, this here it says, for every 10 minutes it stopped, the temperature in the trailer goes up by 1.4 degrees. You can imagine on a hot summer day the real challenges that we're going to have with animal welfare in that truck the longer that they're stopped to try to determine, are they a risk, where are they going, what are they doing? And so I would argue that really, the day of an outbreak, everything should continue to move to where it's going. Really, what you need to focus on is what's the rules for tomorrow's movements, because we've got a lot more flexibility in our world if the animals stay on farm and whether they're in a truck. And so I really do worry about any type of stop movement approach with livestock, and especially in the pork industry. And then I was talking to Sherry about, I said, hey, probably not that big of a deal in the wintertime, and she said, no, Patrick, you got to remember that in the wintertime, there's specifications for getting the truck ported up just right to allow enough airflow. And in the wintertime, it can be worse because you don't have the air movement because you've got those trucks ported up. And so I learned a lesson there. And so to me, the more I study this stop movement stuff, I don't like it. And the reason I don't like it is because we're going to end up with pigs and any other animals that go in these type of containers. We're going to end up with a welfare issue there that will far eclipse the outbreak itself, in my opinion. On the farm, we've got a three-day holding capacity, about 3 to 7, depending on who you talk to, but that's another one there. Obviously, feeding space. This would be the same in the poultry industry, especially when you look at how we time feed deliveries and when feed runs out. It's not like you can just run down to the farm supply and pick up another 10 bags and put it in your feed bin. But we also have to consider that if we do stop movements, we've got an economic disruption like I talked about earlier. There's a lot of people relying on our products that we produce so they can produce their products so we can provide products to the consumer. If you look at real world numbers, as I was talking about, and this is where I'm kind of basing this, what have we gained if we do any type of stop movement, is if we've got a maximum incubation of FMD of being 14 days, and USDA will have to go back 2 times that as far as their epidemiology from when the disease hit. If you assume that in a perfect world, we have a producer that detects that first case 3 days after it's introduced to the herd, you assume 24 hours for the foreign animal disease investigation and transportation and workup. We're talking about 4 days that this disease, in the best case scenario, 4 days where this disease could have been circulating before. Now, these numbers are a little bit, this would be my hopeful situation, that you'd have somebody astute enough that they'd see it right after it's introduced. But most of this work that I've seen estimates that it's probably going to be floating around for about 14 days or even longer before we really get a hold of this thing. So again, in my mind, if you're gonna do a stop movement, I'm not sure you gain anything from a disease aspect and you're losing things from a welfare aspect. And then for us, anytime you back us up in the system, we had basically 600,000 to 1 million pigs that should have moved. So if you back us up 3 days in a stop movement or some type of quarantine or that type of deal, then we've got to account for those million animals that didn't go somewhere. And that's when we're going to run into some real welfare issues again with making sure that those animals have appropriate spacing on the farms, are fed, the husbandry, that type of work. So I'm a big fan of managed movement from a welfare perspective because that's going to actually save us or improve the welfare of animals that are out there. Let's see here. Talk a little bit about euthanasia, and I'm not going to talk about mechanisms or this, that, and the other, but what I want to say is that when we're doing this for disease, we've got to make sure that we got the right tools for the job. And that's what the AVMA has. You know, we've got our methods for humane euthanasia, but there's also industry tools that are out there to make sure that we're doing the using the appropriate tool for the appropriate job. Oh, and by the way, these are avian athletes. That's the terminology I use for them now. The other thing I want to talk about here is selecting the method. And again, these are addressed in USDA's response plans as well. But this one on the right is very concerning to me because this was not the last Korean outbreak, but the one before that. And if you get a real close look at that, those pigs are actually still alive. And I've got a real problem with that type of euthanasia. That's just not something that we can even dream of allowing here in the United States. We need to have professional people out there using methods that are tested and appropriate for what you need to get accomplished. Also, when carrying out the task, what I learned in exotic Newcastle's disease outbreak is that if you're going to be loading or moving animals that are undergoing some of these severe diseases, it's not as easy as if you're just loading hogs out to take them to the packing plant. I remember we were moving birds in the END outbreak. We were moving some pheasants around, and it really drove home the point that these animals don't want to move. They're sick. And so you have to take extra precautions on addressing their welfare issues while trying to move them or utilize a technique for humane euthanasia. But the other thing from a welfare perspective is the human component, and this is also really important. I killed a lot of chickens in California. I'm not a particular fan of chickens, but I certainly didn't feel good after a week of doing it. And really, the biggest issue with the welfare component of an outbreak is taking care of those folks that are going to have to respond. And so, for me, if we're going to help manage welfare on the farm during these outbreaks, the first thing that we need is good, accurate information for state vets to make the best decisions on the size of our zones. We have to get out producer education and resources to them to make sure that they know exactly what is going on and what they need to do. But the other thing that we need to do is focus, and this is where checkoff is going for the pork side, is helping producers with stop movement plans. We'll be putting together a group to discuss that. But we also need to have some good euthanasia and disposal plans for producers to actually use as part of the outbreak, be a part of it, as opposed to just waiting for information to come to them during.